We ready?
Well, today, Americans breathe a sigh of relief because the health care of millions has been protected and preserved. We Democrats believe this is not a day for celebration, but a day to roll up our sleeves and work to make the health care system better than it is today. The bottom line is very simple. The reason this bill failed is because millions of Americans didn't want it. The overwhelming majority of Americans didn't want it. They saw that it would take their health care away. People with disabilities, people with opioid addictions, people with parents in nursing homes, veterans who depended on Medicaid. From one end of America to the other, the Cassidy-Graham bill would have been a health care disaster. The American people saw it, rose to the occasion, and our colleagues had no choice in the face of opposition from one end of the land to the other to withdraw their bill. Now, we hope that the Republicans don't come back to this bill. It'll meet with the same fate that it met with this time, ultimately because people didn't like it. And the bottom line is very, very simple. People want to improve the health care system. Better health care, more people covered, lower premiums. They don't want to retract the health care system and leave them out there to fend for themselves. And we hope that our Republican colleagues realize it. As for ourselves, we are ready at this moment, now that this bill has been withdrawn, to roll up our sleeves and work in a bipartisan way with our Republican colleagues to stabilize the system and make improvements. We think we have advanced greatly in health care, and the American people agree. The majority now support ACA, but none of us think it's perfect. None of us. And Senator Murray and Senator Alexander were very close to an agreement to stabilize the system and improve it. We are ready to move forward on the kind of agreement they've talked about. And we hope that our Republican colleagues will understand that their job is to improve health care for the American people, not to just hold back and try to point fingers of blame, because ultimately, with a Republican president, a Republican House, and a Republican Senate, if the system is destabilized, if the system is sabotaged, it's going to fall on their shoulders. So it makes no sense, absolutely no sense, for them to hold back, and we hope they won't. I'd like to just salute our Democratic colleagues, our Democratic unity, to help people with health care, from the most liberal member of our caucus to the most conservative member of our caucus, was strong and permanent. And it will stay that way. It will stay that way. And so we hope we can move forward and improve health care, not engage in another battle to take it away from people, because they will fail once again if they try. Senator Murray.
Well, we're not out of the woods by any means, and until Trump Care is finally set aside, we will not stop fighting back, because this last one was the worst version yet. But thanks to the patients and families who have so bravely spoken out, and to the Senate Republicans who have called for regular order and real solutions instead of a rushed partisan process, it sounds like the path for the latest version of Trump Care has led to another dead end. That is good news. So I want to again make very clear that I and Democrats are ready to keep working on the bipartisan path that could actually lead to a result. Chairman Alexander and I had been making great progress towards our goal of stabilizing the market and reducing premiums, with many members on and off our committees until the Republican leaders pulled the rug from us. And now, 2 weeks since our last meeting, our last hearing, have been wasted, 2 weeks of partisanship and dysfunction, 2 weeks of threats to families, 2 weeks of President Trump continuing to sabotage the health care and refusing to do the right thing, and 2 weeks of inaction when we could have been working to wrap up this bipartisan deal. So we are here 2 weeks later, right up against a deadline, insurance rates are being finalized tomorrow. Damage has been done already. Premiums are very likely to rise because of President Trump and Republican leaders, but we still can get a result to help the people we serve. So we need to pick up right back where we left off, and we need to do it right now, because the sooner we can get an agreement, the sooner we can act to stop President Trump's sabotage and prevent these premiums from increasing even further. The clock is ticking. Democrats are at the table, and I hope Republican leaders will now allow us to get back to work on lowering costs for patients and families and stabilizing the marketplace. Thank you.
Senator Hass, member of the Health Committee, which Patty is ranking member of.
Well, thank you, Senator Schumer and Senator Murray. I, too, am cautiously encouraged by the majority's decision to withdraw the bill today and agree with Senator Murray. We were making good progress in our HELP committee on bipartisan solutions to stabilize the market, lower costs, and ultimately improve care for the American people. But I do want to express some caution here and return to an exchange that happened last night during the CNN debate, because it involved a constituent of mine from New Hampshire, and because I think it reflects the flaw in the substance of all of the Trump care efforts and the latest Graham Cassidy Trump care effort. A Granite Stater named Ashley shared her story, as she has shared it before, of substance use disorder. She talked about the fact that she lost her husband to an overdose and then eventually, through New Hampshire's drug court program and through Medicaid expansion, got treatment. Ashley's now in recovery. She gets her insurance now through her private employer. So she asked my colleague from South Carolina how to respond to the fact that without Medicaid expansion, she wouldn't have had access to the treatment that has helped her get well. And the good news is that my colleague from South Carolina acknowledged that substance use disorder is a disease. The difficulty is that he then said to her, and this is a quote, "It's not Medicaid expansion that saved you." I think that reflects an absolutely fundamental lack of understanding, not only of the opioid crisis and the importance of healthcare coverage for people who suffer from substance use disorder, but I also think it reflects a disconnect here between the Trump care efforts and the real goal of providing lower costs and better health care for the American people. Ashley knows that without health insurance coverage, you often can't access treatment. When people tell constituents that they don't understand their own health care journey, it demeans that journey, and it demeans the constituents. It demeans the very people we should be listening to and who we are sent here to represent and to help. Our constituents are telling us about their personal experiences with healthcare. They are often really laying themselves bare before us so that we will understand the importance of healthcare and health coverage to them. We have seen people come to the Capitol this week and all summer who suffer with significant disabilities, and it is not easy for a lot of these people to get here, to be out in the sun, to wait in long lines, and frankly, they shouldn't have to. They shouldn't have to come to Capitol Hill and beg for health insurance coverage, not in the United States of America. So, we know that there is more to do on health care. There isn't a Democrat here who doesn't know that there are improvements we need to make. I am committed to working with members of both parties on the HELP Committee and throughout the United States Senate to come together and find ways in the short term to stabilize our markets and lower costs. We have to address pharmaceutical costs. We have to address health care outcomes. But as long as there is this threat out there of another Trump care attempt, it's going to be harder for us to do that. And it's going to cause disruption in the very lives of the people we were sent here to represent, who don't choose to get ill, They don't choose to experience a disability. They don't decide that they're eager to go to a nursing home. They need our help, and they need us to listen to them about the way healthcare actually works. And if we do that, we'll forge our way forward and bring real results for the American people. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Hassan. I'm going to say a few words about Puerto Rico, and then we'll open it up to questions on both subjects, on all subjects. Okay. So, a couple of hours ago, I spoke again with the governor of Puerto Rico. As they and the U.S. Virgin Islands are recovering from significant damage after Hurricane Maria, it is impossible to overstate the seriousness of the situation on the island. I have never seen any disaster take a toll on an area in my whole lifetime like it has on this one. I asked the governor what was needed. His requests were clear. We are calling on the administration to immediately give Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands the assistance it needs. We are calling on the president to have all hands on deck and give Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands the help they need and do it now. First, Puerto Rico needs additional security presence of at least 1,000 to 1,500 people. They need U.S. military disaster and humanitarian assistance to help maintain order and man the food and fuel. Because the island is so disrupted, they don't even have the personnel when they have food to get it to the people who need it. And the people can't get there half the time. Second, they need additional first responders and all available resources to help restore communications on the island. Many of the cell towers are down. Communications to so many people is remote and gone. Third, they need at least 200 generators right now. They need additional fuel. They need fuel trucks. They don't have any of that. All the overlying power lines, including the main trunk power lines that are above ground, were destroyed. The only people who have power are those who got their power from underground lines. And about the personnel, they are now bivouacking, helicoptering in certain medicines that people depend on. They have to fly them in from far away and then somehow get them to the people who need them. Fourth, they need hundreds of power workers to get the power back up and running. And fifth and lastly, but very importantly, FEMA and the Coast Guard need to get the Roosevelt Roads Naval Station, which is now also an airport, back up and running. They need a port. Our military and our Coast Guard know how to build temporary ports, because while planes can fly a certain amount of goods and food and medicine in, ships can do it much more effectively and efficiently, larger numbers. They need this Roosevelt Roads Naval Station. So they need to get these things done and get them now. Mr. President, these are American citizens. They desperately need our help. We need all hands on deck in every relevant federal agency to help and help now. Okay, we're ready for your questions. Go ahead.
Well, they just walked out of their caucus and announced that they were not moving forward. I just walked out of mine, so I haven't had a chance to talk to them. I have been very clear and consistent. I'm ready to go. The minute they say he's okay to go.
I saw Senator Alexander in the gym this morning, and I told him,
yes,
I told him we wanted to move forward, that Senator Murray is eager to move forward because she talked to me about this, and he seemed open to it. Here's the bottom line. There are lots of good plans out there. Some Democrats support one, some Democrats support the other. I haven't co-sponsored any of them as of yet. However, there's a big difference between the two parties. Every Democratic plan wants to expand health care, help people, more people get better health care. Every Republican plan wants to cut back on health care. That's the difference between the parties that I hope will change now that this bill has been defeated. As for single payer, I think that was a straw man for them, a very unsuccessful one at that. And the debate showed it last night. I think relief efforts could do a whole lot better. I talked to the governor of Puerto Rico. They need so much, so much. And if we need to pass legislation, we passed Harvey relief within a week of Harvey hitting landfall. I hope we can do the same with Puerto Rico. I haven't looked at that yet, so I couldn't answer it. Well, we're glad that some new Republicans are supporting citizenship, but the bill has a lot of deficiencies, and Senator Durbin will be talking and meeting with Senator Tillis to discuss those.
Is the Dream Act a red line for Democrats?
Look, we don't draw lines in the sand, but at the White House, the President said to Leader Pelosi and I that he would support the Durbin Graham bill.
That doesn't sound like they are getting off of this idea of repeal and replace. And you have said repeatedly, once they die,
I think if they, the reason it failed is because the American people really didn't like it, not just marginally, but by a huge margin. If they go back to it, they're going to find the same situation, and they'll fail again. What are you talking about, Puerto Rico? I spoke to the governor of Puerto Rico. I asked him his five top needs. I've just told you them. We hope the administration can act on those now. I didn't get in. I asked him for, he's very busy. I asked him for his needs. These are things that have not been done yet. So they need them, and they need them now. As to what the fingers of blame are that they haven't been done yet, I don't know enough to comment. I'm not blaming. I'm beseeching for quick action. I didn't think when the president said yesterday, I think in his tweet, that everything's going fine is correct. As for who's to blame, I don't know, but it is not going fine. Absolutely not. Patty.
Let me speak to what we are focused on, which is market stabilization. We had four hearings, Republican and Democratic governors, insurance commissioners from both sides, and every one of them told us that making sure that the president made the payments that he can right now without any legislative action is the single most important thing to do over the next several years to stabilize the marketplace, which will reduce the premiums for everyone. So that has to, if the president is not going to do it, Congress has to act. The president can do that on his own right now and bring stability like today to that. But without that, that's part of it. Making sure that we look at several other provisions that allow this to move forward better in states are something else that we can do in the short term. So what Lamar and I are rightfully focused on right now is the short-term stability of the insurance marketplace so that premiums do not go up.
And Patty and Lamar are two good, terrific negotiators. I believe left to themselves, without anyone putting pressure on them not to do it, it can happen and happen quickly. Okay? Last one. That's why they need personnel. They don't have the infrastructure now. That's why they're calling for actual personnel. They could be military personnel. They could be civilian FEMA personnel. They need a lot more personnel to carry out all the things that need to be done and done quickly. Low interest loans are down the road. They need help now. Thank you.